Okay, Marty, people will probably continue to join us after we start, but I think we'll go ahead and get things rolling. Everyone, I'm Justin Gunther, the director here at Fallingwater, and thank you so much for joining us for the first of this year's webinars for the Fallingwater webinar series. And we have in store what I think will be a really exciting presentation on the topic of jazz, modernism, and Frank Lloyd Wright. And for Frank Lloyd Wright, architecture and music were one and the same. They belonged together. He thought they were practically one in terms of the ideas of composition. He just saw them really aligning one with the other. And Frank Lloyd Wright was drawn to the ideas of pattern, rhythm, and structure that you find in music. And Marty, he often wrote that buildings were basically edifices of sound. So they were these physical manifestations of musical composition. And that really rings true here at Fallingwater. When Wright was conceiving of the design, he wrote that he was designing Fallingwater to the music of the stream. So the architecture really is meant to be this embodiment of this idea of the rushing cascade. If you can kind of think of Fallingwater as this crescendo of musical and architectural composition, rising up in the landscape up over the waterfall. So today, Marty Ashby from MCG Jazz is going to talk to us about this idea of Wright's architecture and jazz composition. And I love that because Wright's architecture was all about being experimental and inventive and forward thinking. And what if not is jazz for the modern era in terms of music, those same principles creating the foundation of jazz. But let me introduce you to our speaker, Marty Ashby, who, if you're not from Pittsburgh, he's a Pittsburgh rock star in the jazz world. But Marty Ashby is a jazz guitarist, a Grammy Award-winning producer, programming consultant, motivational speaker, and lifelong advocate of jazz music in its unique place in American culture. He's the executive producer of MCG Jazz, which is the Manchester Craftsman's Guild Jazz, which he started in 1987. And since then he has produced more than 2000 concerts and over 55 recordings. I don't know how you have time to do 2000 concerts and 55 recordings. That's quite an accomplishment. But the MCG Jazz label has garnered 5 Grammy Awards and 11 Grammy nominations in addition to those 5 awards. For more than 3 decades, Marty has been the artistic advisor and producer for jazz concerts and festivals around the country. He was the EPP Goldman-Sachs Fellow at the National Museum of American History at the Smithsonian, and also produced the Smithsonian Jazz Masterworks Orchestra, Jazz Beyond Borders, for their 2019 international tour. He has presented his Jazz and Life Professional Development Workshop to corporate and community audiences nationally and internationally. And something that was really important for Pittsburgh in 2018, Marty produced a documentary film, which I encourage you to find and watch, which is called We Knew What We Had, The Greatest Jazz Story Never Told, which explores the historical context and social conditions here in Pittsburgh that made the city one of the leading contributors to jazz music in the entire world. Marty's latest venture is as a certified vibrational sound therapist, which uses Tibetan bowls, as well as advanced Reiki and Biofield tuning. He's deeply committed to these ideas of the healing power that music and sound can have for our health. And a couple quick housekeeping items before I turn it over to Marty. As you have questions during Marty's presentation, if you'll type those into the Q&A field or in the chat field, Marty, I think we'll save maybe about 10 minutes at the end to field some of those questions. And again, we're recording today's session, so it'll be available on our website and the webinars section of the fallingwater.org website. And also encourage everyone to look out for our next webinar, which is on April 26th, which will be about the idea of beauty, neuroscience, and architecture. So again, this idea of how beauty is important to our mental health, and you'll hear some beautiful sounds coming from Marty today. So Marty, I'll turn it over to you to tell us all about jazz, modernism, and Frank Lloyd Wright.
Well, thank you, Justin, and hello, everyone. It's great to be here. You just made me tired, though, man. All those things the last 40 years.
I don't know how you find the time to do all that stuff.
Well, you know,
it's remarkable. In fact,
the older I get, the more ideas I have to do more different things. Kind of hence what we're talking about today. It's kind of a collective experience piece that's adding up. And I'm thrilled to be here. I'm an unbelievable fan of Master Wright's work. And this all started basically for me. I'm going to give you the short story of how I kind of got on to Mr. Wright's architecture, and then take you on a little bit of a journey of what's happened the last 40 years. And then we'll get to Falling Water and talk about that. So that's kind of the structure. And we'll play a little music along the way from me live to some recorded things and some other stuff. So basically, in fact, I'm going to share my screen here, if I may, if this is all going to work. I hope it will. Boom. And we're going to share. And we're going to do this. How's that? Everybody in? Perfect. So, short story of how this came together for me and my connection. I was in Ithaca College. This was 1981-ish, 82. And in those days, you couldn't major in jazz guitar. I had to be a classical guitar major because jazz was still considered kind of a four-letter word at many of the music conservatories around the country. There was a few that you could major in jazz, but not very many. And so I ended up helping to create a degree there called the BFA Jazz Studies, which is a Bachelor of Fine Arts in Jazz. What that kind of forced me to do, thank God, is take things in art class and some TV. I ended up producing TV shows as part of it. And one class that I needed to get out and graduate was called Contemporary Art in Architecture. Judith Pempel, I believe is her name, that taught the class, and it just blew my mind. I was from Central New York and was not that exposed to a whole bunch of modern art in my high school at the time, and was not really familiar with Frank Lloyd Wright. And so I ended up writing a paper that I credit for getting me out of my undergrad at Ithaca College, entitled Frank Lloyd Wright, One of the Great Jazz Musicians of Our Time. And I had a whole bunch of different kind of connective tissue things at the time, and this is 40 years ago. So for the first couple minutes here, I'm going to maybe just go through some of those connector points that I made, and then we'll talk a little bit about what I've done and kind of come to understand since then. And one of which is that I noticed that Mr. Wright was a master improviser, and that he had, as I studied some of his buildings, a vocabulary, a palette, like we do in jazz. And you can hear two notes of Dizzy Gillespie or Stanley Turrentine or any number, Louis Armstrong, and you know it's them playing. And it's the same thing with Mr. Wright. You see some of his elements of his line, his design, and the rhythmic nature of his thing, and the color palette. You know, his color palette is so so unique and so identifiable. And what I noticed in looking at it is architecture is that he would take the same elements, basically, and mix them up differently. Let me see if I can give you a musical example of that, and then we'll get into some other things here. So in jazz, we have a simple harmony. What will I play? So we'll play a 1-6-2-5. So one chord to a six chord, to a two chord, to a five. So we can think of that as some of his elements, like maybe a certain kind of color, the red, the Cherokee red, the Frank Lloyd Wright red. Maybe that's a certain doorway that's shorter because he liked that compression piece coming in. Maybe the two chord is one of his elements of using Oriental design and some things. And this can be of your choosing. You're all right fans probably. So four elements per se, right? There are infinite ways to put those four elements together, or those four opportunities of his architecture. So let me see, show you kind of how we do that in music quick. So I'm playing. And could go on forever playing different variations, just like what to me, and again, this is just my perception 40 years ago, that he did with his different elements. So let me move on here. So I saw this, and this, for those of you that don't know, probably everybody does, is the curtain at the theater in Taliesin in Wisconsin, the Hillside Theater. And when I saw this in a book, I was like, oh my God, that is swinging so hard, right? It is just, actually, you can see here with my mouse, I think it is, I see the melody, look at these melody lines and all these other notes, the rhythm. I mean, the rhythm is just, it's just swinging through the whole thing here. And these colors, that's the harmony. I mean, it's such rich harmony. So when I saw that, I said, oh my goodness. And of course, I was writing this paper and I was trying to make, you know, analogies to other things. And I found this is the Modrian Broadway Boogie Woogie. And those, to me, there was a lot of similarities in how those things were just moving and swinging and working together. And then I got onto some music. In the day, when he was designing Fallingwater specifically, is what I kind of targeted a lot of it about, it was in the 30s. It was, I think, Justin, 35 to 39 or something when it was built. So he was thinking about it in the early 30s. The jazz age was the 20s. Heard a lot of small group jazz stuff. We know that Mr. Wright was a big classical music fan, listened to a lot of classical music and played the piano and all that. But in the early 30s, when the Depression hit, a lot of the orchestra recordings and things weren't able to happen because some of the orchestras went out of business, the record companies couldn't afford to record big orchestras, etc. Jazz, as we probably all know, became the pop music. It was played everywhere. You couldn't possibly not hear it. So the supposition that I made back in 1981 or 82 was that Mr. Wright was extremely influenced by jazz music because he had to hear it everywhere. And the homes and his clients and everything, it was everywhere. People wanted to go out and dance all through the 30s. It wasn't until 1937 that the NBC radio orchestra that Toscanini conducted came on the air and would do national broadcasts and so on and so forth. So in the early 30s, it was a lot of jazz. And so what I figured out is, for me at least, that there's certain elements, and I just picked out a few here. I got these little 30-second clips I want to play a little bit of for you, that to me, again, represented elements in Mr. Wright's work. So this is, if I can get it to play, this is something you recognize. It is Sing, 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 Benny Goodman. And these were all top hits, by the way, in the 30s, either number one or in the top two or three. And the element of surprise is what this example exemplifies. Starts with the floor tom, boom, dagadoom, 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 gadagadoom, dagadoom, right? And then this clarinet comes in and all that. So I just playing you the end where that had built up to this. Come on, cursor. It's very finicky, this one. Kind of mysterious. Couldn't swing any harder, right? Right? Is that fun or what? Right? So, element of surprise, one of the elements. There's these six elements here. This is Tommy Dorsey, and it is his In a Sentimental Mood, and this is all about melody, lyricism, line, some of Mr. Wright's lines, which we'll look at some of these homes later, just gorgeous lines, just like this melody. Come along. There you are. you get the idea. I could listen to this music all day. And so that's the idea of melody. And again, he had to listen to all this stuff. This is Coleman Hawkins, a tune, Body and Soul. Let's see. Right? So that's the tune, Body and Soul. And what Coleman does with it is you'll hear a little taste, and he improvises around the melody in just such an unbelievably brilliant way. Remember, this was on the radio in the 30s, this gorgeous ballad with him improvising the melody, which became a classic. And to me, it's got Wright written all over it, and how he would improvise. Here it is. Right? Gorgeous. Here's one you're going to recognize. Now this is Glenn Miller, In the Mood, one of the all-time hits. But I don't know what key they're in, probably A-flat, you know, boo-ba-dee-ba-doo-ba-doo-ba-dee-ba-doo-ba-dee-ba-doo-ba-dee. So at the end, he plays it loudly, then he comes down soft, 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 softer. And then he opens it up again. Compression and release. It's like when you walk into falling water, you're kind of down, and then it's opened up. So many of Mr. Wright's homes, as I'm sure most of you know, have compression and release. And to me, this tune is perfect. I just got the end of it here, where they're kind of soft and then it'll get big. Yeah, A flat, for those of you taking notes. And that extra bar in there, nice. Walk into the living room, right? So you got the idea here. Duke Ellington, this is actually a piece written a couple years after the 30s. It's called Tonk. It's written by Billy Strayhorn, Pittsburgher. And to me, this shows kind of the complexity of the music and the multi-level layers of things and the busyness of it all. And some of Mr. Wright's architecture, you see these multi-layers of things, and seems like a lot's going on, but yet it's all connected. So this is just a little example of that, again, from my perspective. So much going on there. It's fascinating. And oh, by the way, I'll post and I'll send it to you as well, Justin, the kind of complete playlist of the music that we're listening to today. And I'll post it under news on my website, which is just MartyAshby.com. Under news, I'll post all these recordings and other ones that we're going to play. Last but not least is Fred Astaire. And you're going to hear in a second just this wonderful version of what I call groove. It's just swinging, doesn't stop. It's like Mr. Wright's Buildings. We're going to see one in a second. that looks like it could just go off forever and just go just forever in it. And this is an example of that, if it will work for me. There we go.
Heaven, I'm in heaven, and my heart beats so that I can hardly speak, and I seem to find the happiness I seek when we're out together dancing cheek to cheek. Heaven, I'm in heaven, and the cares that hung around me through the week.
Right. You get it, right?
Like a gambler's lucky streak.
Come on.
When we're all together. So
those are the six elements that I kind of identified and taken to another place. So I'm going to kind of turn the corner here a little bit and talk about what happened the next 30 some odd years or so when I ended up in Pittsburgh after undergrad. And of course, immediately went to Fallingwater to see that. Was working at the time for the Pittsburgh Symphony when I first moved here. Then a guy by name of Bill Strickland, some of you may have heard of, a genius, a mentor of mine the last 35 plus years, built this place that I'm in now. This is part of the recording studio I'm in here at Manchester Craftsman's Guild. And I got a call in 1987 to come over and see the space and tour it. It had just been completed. The paint was still wet on the music hall, and I came over here and walked in the building and knew that I was home. And here's the building. Oh, don't do that. Yeah, it does this sometimes. So that's a little cacophony of that. Here's the building. Absolutely gorgeous, inside and out. And I didn't know even that day, it was another day actually, that it was designed by Tasso Katsalis, who was in the last class with Mr. Wright directly, as a student of his. So there's a ton of Wrightisms, if you will, in this building. In fact, Bill commissioned a Japanese cabinet maker to build 60 pieces of furniture and art in the building. And the thing about this building is it's full of light. I walk down this hallway every day, and every day it just swings a little bit better. I walk it through the hallway to kind of get to the music hall, and the light changes. You can stand in the lobby and it can be overcast, which in Pittsburgh, unfortunately, it is very often, but it never feels that way. And of course, there's a music hall here as well. And there it is. And we just completely redid the music hall during shutdown. Doesn't look like this anymore. It's basically the same design, but the cosmetics and sound is totally different. And I invite you all to come and see a concert and see the building here. You can get that just at mcgjazz.org. And it's been a great experience to work here for 35 years in this environment, because environment means everything. And Mr. Wright knew that, and it shapes how you feel every day. So I still, after all these years, walk in the building and see a big blank white canvas and say, what colors are we going to paint with today? And it's been a really an amazing run of what we've been able to do. And a lot of that I really attribute to the environment, there's no question. And you know, the philosophy of the place and all that obviously means a lot as well, but environment is very important. So spin the tape forward. To the next slide here, and you all know that that's of course Taliesin West. So you know, came to Pittsburgh and got married, and as part of our honeymoon we went to Phoenix, and I can suggest that if you get married in July, don't go to Phoenix as part of your honeymoon. The golf was not quite so much fun, and the however, the architecture and going to see Taliesin West was just phenomenal. And I saw this from afar, and I just immediately saw, you can see these lines, whoops, let me go back one. These lines here, there's the cursor. See these windows? To me, those are like quarter notes and then they continue down here, right? And they just keep grooving with a slightly different texture. And then they just go off into the sunset and groove forever, just like we heard with, you know, and heaven. Keeping going and going and going. So I saw that subdivision, then the beautiful line of it, and then you go inside and oh my goodness. Then this to me is John Coltrane, you know, all the complex angles and the colors and the harmony and melody and rhythm. You can see the lines. It just completely blew my mind. And I'll admit that I had not really thought much about, you know, the paper and the connection that I had done now 10 years ago or so at that time. And when I saw these spaces, it just completely blew my mind. And when we got to this, that was it. I was done. I was completely hooked forever, because I remember walking in here and thinking it was the hippest jazz club I'd ever seen in my life. Right there, you've got the you know, the melody of the lines of the architecture, the stone, these lines that kind of lead you to the stage, you know, the harmony of the space and the colors, and you got melody screaming all over the place in the lights and the seats, and it just is a warmth, right? So this piece I'm going to play a little bit of here is from one of our recordings. It's the great Stanley Turrentine. It's kind of the MCG theme song here that we commissioned him to write some years ago. And let the intro, a little short intro, just envision yourself kind of coming in and sitting down, you know, you're kind of coming in, you're sitting down in your seat, and then the melody starts. And it's just in the pocket and groovy, and you'll see what I mean if I can make it work. There we go. Listen to this bass riff. It goes. Okay, yeah. Sorry. There we go. Yeah, that bass lick that Dwayne Dolphin plays at Pittsburgh are great basses. Roger Humphreys on drums. Dave Budway, another great Pittsburgh, on piano. My brother Jay on trombone with Stanley Turrentine, the great saxophonist. That bass lick is one of the great bass licks of all time that, to me, kind of summarizes the simplicity yet clarity of line and the greasiness of all this. To me, this is like a speakeasy jazz club that has all those elements. So I could talk forever on this, but I won't. I will try to get to the next slide. So. Spin the tape forward a little bit, come back to Pittsburgh after the honeymoon and had to find a place to live. And we were looking for, you know, a house that we wanted. We wanted kind of a mid-century Usonian knockoff is what we really were hoping for. We got turned on to a neighborhood, said you might look around there. So we're driving around, there are all different colonial houses. We come around the corner and we see this house. And we said, well, you know, if we wanted to live in this neighborhood, this would be the house that we'd want to have, full of light all the time, you know. But it wasn't for sale, but as fate would have it, one of my wife's board members knew the owners, and it turned out he was the former CEO of Westinghouse. Make a long story short, jazz is what got us this house, because he was a jazz fan, and the things just worked out, so we got the starving jazz musician discount, and have lived there now for almost 30 years. And living in the environment of that, you know, kind of fishbowl of all the naturalness coming in, has absolutely changed the way that I perceive music, and so many other things, that, of course, Mr. Wright knew in his architecture. So spin the tape forward a little bit more here, and I somehow figured that it would be important to expose our kids to Mr. Wright's architecture. So we went onto this the Seth Peterson Cottage in Wisconsin, where you can stay overnight. Talk about swinging. Just look at the stonework and how the stones that jut out are completely, I mean, to me, that is melody personified right there, with the harmony of not only nature, but just the wood into the stone, with a rhythmic groove as they repeat. It's just, it's all right there. It's beautiful inside, and, you know, imagine creating there. So this piece we're going to play a little bit of is by Ivan Lins, who's a great Brazilian composer friend. I can imagine him with the windows open, hearing the creek river that you can hear, that's down over the hill. You can hear it in the house, hearing the birds and the trees and this beautiful environment, writing this song here. It's gorgeous. Again, if I can make it work, here we go. Sorry, I could listen to that all day. That's from a live recording we did here at MCG Jazz. It's a beautiful, beautiful recording. But can't you just picture Ivan sitting there with a piano and the windows open and him writing that song? The energy of that and taking into that, taking the environment into that, just spectacular. So I ended up taking a bunch of these trips with the kids and my wife to see these other homes. There we go. So this is the gate to the Lewis Penfield house in near Cleveland that you can also stay in. And we went through the gate, and the kids were just fascinated that you had to go through a gate, so you have to close it. So they wanted to get out and close it. And it just, the nature of that gate to me, it just feels like a composition in and of itself, in such a musical way. And then when you get to the house, you know, I mean, talk about, you know, I mean, I just look at it and I can just see that, you know. Just walking down forever and ever, right? You move inside and look at the light. Absolutely, simply amazing. And you get inside and I begin to hear some other things. You know, it's just such a peacefulness. I remember waking up in the morning and saw this. And the light just slowly morphed over the wall, like a sonata, like a jazz sonata, like a most beautiful ballad, you know. In a minute or two, it'd move. Another minute, it'd move again. Then it would feel like it starts all over, you know. Really, you know, a lovely experience, and I think that that's, you know, what I was, you know, trying to get at all these years, of really kind of understand that in a musical context of how light worked in Mr. Wright's buildings. That's my son pretending to be Frank Lloyd Wright. What fun, right? And then we get here. So about 15 years ago or more, we wanted to bring the jazz industry together, the leaders of the jazz industry, to try to figure out this whole jazz's life piece that we do workshops on now, and just how we could synergize members of the jazz industry. So we brought together the heads of major record companies, major festivals like the Monterey Festival, National Public Radio, National Endowment for the Arts, a whole bunch of industry leaders. BET Television at the time was really big doing jazz things. And some great musicians. Dr. Billy Taylor was there, some of you may remember from CBS Sunday Morning, as well as one of the greatest jazz musicians and one of my personal mentors for decades. And so we came together at the house, and the Johnson Foundation graciously hosted us for this, you know, 3-day conference, which was spectacular. I mean, this building is, the difference in this is you see how it just, the energy is just like soaring up to the stars, right? And you see that the, you know, this strong bass and groundedness is kind of growing everybody up, and to a one, everybody felt that. You know, here we are, you know, we're talking about jazz's life over here, you see, and some of these other branding things, and we're sitting around these tables in this amazing environment. Every evening, we'd come to this area, and there'd be one of the greatest musicians in the world serenading us. Absolutely amazing stuff. And it, to me, again, it tied together some of that architecture with jazz. This is a Bob Mincer piece, one of our other recordings from here. See how it's moving the eighth notes and 16th notes, like these windows here, but other textures coming in and out. Starts building and building, right? Kind of reaching for the heavens. Multimeter stuff, like his architecture's a little angular there. Let me see if I can. All right. Again, I'll give you the playlist for all these things. It's really great, great stuff. And that brings me, if I can get to it, to the Roby home, yet another trip. Kids are getting bigger. And, you know, this is just layers of swing to me. I've got a quick clip I'm going to play and kind of talk over here as well. This is the Count Basie Orchestra, again, from one of our live recordings. In fact, our first recording that won a Grammy is this recording. But you'll see how it kind of layers in with the melody. So we're swinging. We're down at the bottom here, right? We're just swinging. Walking along. Swinging. Grooving. Like it can last forever, right? Little melody line going. Now we're adding up, you know, this other layer of stuff. All this stuff in here is adding in. Goes on, and of course this piece, you know, builds and continues to do that, adding more and more and more sections. You get the idea, right? It's great, it's great. And this building, I remember when I saw it, it just completely blew me away with the immediate sense of groove in it, right? There we go. There's the house inside. I've got a couple of those sconces in our house, actually, the wall sconces, which, you know, that's a day conversation, just talking about that. And the energy in the room. This is our dining room, which I took this photo yesterday evening when I got home. I saw this light and I said, ooh, right, I forget. We live in this. And this dining room table, you know, Mr. Wright, you know, had the idea that he had the tall back chairs because then you make a room within a room, right? And I can't tell you how many times for the last 30 years, and I had these chairs commissioned by a local woodworker to kind of emulate Robie Home chairs. And when you're at the table, A, you have to sit up straight, which helps your digestion, of course. And the conversation gets focused in on the table. Dinner will be over, and we'll sit there, whether it's just the four of us, the kids and Carol and I, or if we have relatives over, and talk for hours, because the energy feels right to do that, which is, I think, why Mr. Wright did that. And as you can see, the light in the house and everything. So that, again, environment kind of dictates so much here. But let's move on to this. Need I say more? It's got it all right there. The essence of melody and harmony and rhythm and groove and swing and texture and all of it in one spot. And I just want to, so we can get into some questions here. I see we've got some hands raised and stuff. We've done some concerts here, which have been absolutely fabulous. That's Frank Vignola in the middle of his trio. There's only 35 people or something like that attend, but the energy when we've done these concerts there has been spectacular, absolutely amazing. And I actually got to do one with Gloria Rubin, who's a wonderful singer and actress. In fact, she's got a new movie this Saturday on the Hallmark Channel that Gloria is starring in, if you are a Hallmark movie fan. And when we played there, I have to say that, as I was telling Justin earlier, that I felt something incredibly powerful that I'd never really felt before on the bandstand. And I'm sure now, as I've been thinking back and playing the tape back and with all the research and studying I've been doing on vibrational energy and healing and so on and so forth, I was more grounded than I'd been on any gig that I've ever done, because obviously you're standing on stone, on a rock, basically. So talk about grounded. But there was something very special about that grounding moment, because the music sounded, when I played a chord in the house, I remember it feeling differently. And as Justin and I were talking earlier, there's got to be some sort of maybe unconscious situation with Mr. Wright's buildings that certain frequencies resonate better than others. And I was saying earlier, I'd love to figure out, you know, with people much smarter than I, how to do a study to really understand what frequencies really resonate in his buildings, because it felt very different. And Fallingwater is, to me, the epitome of a jazz orchestration. You've got the water underneath. So here's melody, harmony, and rhythm in the water, all in itself, right? It has its own melody as it moves. The harmony is how deep it is that day, right? The rhythm is its own thing. I'm going to stop sharing here, by the way, so we can get back to that. And then the house itself you know, give me a break. Every little nook and cranny is its own composition, which I find just fascinating. So thank you for indulging me to go through that little story and share some ideas about jazz and Mr. Wright. And what would you like to do, Justin? We can talk more about Fallingwater if you'd like.
Yeah, let's take some questions. I love how you kind of told your story through your own life and your own experience. And I knew you were a fan, but I didn't know you were such a fan of Frank Lloyd Wright, so immersed in everything that you are and in your life and in your career. It really has had a major influence.
And I didn't really grok it all.
Yeah.
I was putting the slides together, and my guitar, by the way, I don't know if you guys can see, but these frets, the inlays, are all kind of Wrightian designs. I didn't really get how immersed and how his philosophy has shaped so many things that I have done in my career, my life, and with my family, for that matter, until this week. So thanks, Justin.
Well, I mean, and you know, his architecture is all about the human element, and they're such humane experiences. And you talk about being in that living room space, and you know, it is about nature and built environment, fire, water, earth, and air, the elements of the universe converging and coming together in a very relatable, yet you can't put your finger on it kind of way.
Right.
And it's a magical environment to be in. And then when you amplify it with music, like you've done, it just adds a whole nother dimension on top of it. And to that, one of our questions was, well, what are the acoustics like in that space? Can you speak to that a little bit?
Yeah, I didn't know until we tried the first show. You know, we talked about it, and we've been there, and I clapped when I went, and Justin and I were walking around and to see what it was like. And it's unbelievably warm, the warmth of the space. And on the first show with Frank of Vignola, it was so hot that we had to have the windows open and some fans going, so you heard the waterfalls and all of that. And I thought, oh, that could be a problem. But you know what? It worked brilliantly with the music. It just made it even warmer. And when Gloria and I were there, just the two of us, it's very intimate music, the duo. We did a duo record, and very intimate music. And I, you know, Justin, you were there. It felt like it was a soft pair of slippers, man. It was just fabulous.
Wonderful. We have a question, Marty, from Margie Segaline, asking if you know someone named Bob Green who used to work at Westinghouse as a jazz player.
It's not ringing a bell, but it doesn't mean that I haven't met him.
A question from Robert. Any thoughts or comments regarding the historic transition to amplified music from non-amplified music? Other than symphony orchestras, are there other musician purists who avoid contemporary enhancements? We know that Mr. Wright embraced new technology. How do you think he would respond to things like auto-tune and other technological advancements for music? That's a many-layered question, but.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm all about acoustic instruments and the least amount of amplification as possible. You know, if I like, this is totally acoustic here. I love the sound of that. I had a little amp going, so it picked up better in the thing. There's a lot of musicians that prefer it. In fact, this coming weekend, we have Wynton Marsalis and the Lincoln Center Jazz Orchestra here at MCG Jazz on our stage. And they are using no monitors, so no amplification on stage whatsoever. It's all completely acoustic, which I find delicious, and I find that to be the case with many musicians. You know, autotune and all that stuff for recordings and all that, I've used it. And I think the way that, as a producer, I justify some of that is that I'm working with these great musicians, and I know that if they're a little out of tune on one note, I know that they can sing that note in tune or play that note in tune or whatever. And I want to have the best representation of capturing this moment in time on the recordings as possible. But then again, a lot of our recordings are live and can't do that in live records. So it's a balance for sure. The technology is a balance with the art for sure. Good question.
That's a great question. Well, you gave Kimberly Duffin inspiration to pass her architecture licensing exam next week. So that's a great comment.
Good luck.
Her extra inspiration. Yeah. And someone is asking, what was the building that had the stone concert hall? I think they're referring to the space at Taliesin West, right?
Correct.
Marty.
Correct. Yep, that's Taliesin West. Yeah, stunning. Go see it. Not in July, but go see it.
Let's see. And Marty, just to kind of for recapping, and you know, I was trying to take some notes too on your kind of six elements, which I really loved how you summarized that. So it's this idea of surprise, the idea of lines and melody.
Yeah, and I'll give them back to you here. So for
yeah.
And along with the musical examples, again, I'll post this under news and I'll send it to you as well. So I use the sing, 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 Benny Goodman, for the element of surprise, right? Which is Mr. Wright. Tommy Dorsey, getting sentimental over you for melody, just gorgeous melody. Coleman Hawkins, improvising on Body and Soul, and just the you know, the sheer improvisation that Mr. Wright does. Glenn Miller was in the mood, and it comes really down quiet and then it comes back. So that's compression and release, which is so Mr. Wright. And then the Duke Ellington Tonk, which is actually Billy Strayhorn composition, that's about the complex nature of some of his buildings and some of his designs, like we saw at Wingspread, right? The shot of the stairwell, you know, up going to the heavens, how complex that was, but yet it all connected. That was the Duke Ellington. And then just, you know, Fred Astaire was just about swinging and grooving and going on forever. As you see, you know, his homes, man. You could do it forever, right? It just keep going off into the sunset, right? And so that was the kind of element of groove and swing.
We had a question if we will be having more jazz concerts at Fallingwater.
Yes, we will.
Absolutely.
Yeah. As we speak, we're working on it.
Yeah, absolutely. Hopefully. You know, you talked about the kind of rhythm in buildings. I'm looking out my window at some of the stonework of the house. Mm. It almost looks like, you know, the staff of a sheet of music with bit different punctuations of notes, and I think of the multi layers of expression of the house.
Totally.
The whole idea of just there's such richness in music about the whole thing, and you, while there's a, you know, a great sense of calm that you get being in these spaces, it really does make you want to swing.
Yeah.
A little bit.
I think about walking up to the guest house, you know, on the bridge. Yeah. Going up, and you know how it's tiered and stuff, and I can't help but not hear. As I'm walking up, I just hear that it's kind of the beginning of Killer Joe, a great jazz composition. But every time I walk up those steps, that's what I'm hearing is that groove for some reason. It's unnatural.
And I love to, you know, the Kaufmans had a built-in record player put in the living room. So you can just imagine them listening to jazz and dancing in that space, and the acoustics of that, even that record player sounding just spot on in that space.
Hey man, before the next concert, can we do a little record party? And
let's do a record party.
Play some records, man.
Play some records, absolutely. Let the house come alive.
Yeah, man.
Absolutely. Well, this has been an inspiration for me, Marty. I'm gonna spend the rest of my day with a smile on my face, no question, thinking about this. And I know you've inspired a lot of people in the audience to look at Wright's architecture in another way. And what made it all the more powerful is how important it is to you. So really, thank you so much for sharing that with us. It meant a lot to us here at Fallingwater, and I'm sure to the audience as well. So We thank you very much. The presentation was recorded, so we'll make it accessible on the Fallingwater website in our webinars section of our website, so you can find it there. And then Marty, I know you were planning on making it accessible from your end as well. So there'll be multiple ways to find it, and also we'll make the playlist available to you as well. And again, thank you all for joining us. Marty, thank you so much. And we look forward to the next webinar. Again, it's on April 26th on the topic of beauty, neuroscience, and architecture. So we hope some of you will join us for that discussion. Thanks again, Marty.
My pleasure. And folks, feel free to contact me. It's just marty@martyashby.com. Happy to continue the conversation if you'd like to. And Justin, thank you so much, man. This was an honor for me to do this. Thank you.
Absolutely. And check out the concert series at MCG Jazz.
Please do.
If you're a local Pittsburgher. All right. Thanks so much, Marty.
Take care. Bye-bye.